Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? That's great, thank you very much. And we now turn to our next item of business, which is an evidence session on our inquiry into low income and debt problems. Today we are taking evidence from Richard Dennis, the accountant in bankruptcy. Welcome to the committee this morning, and I thank you for joining us. Before I begin, can I remind everyone that broadcasting will operate your microphones. We have around about an hour for this session before we hear from the Scottish Commission on Social Security at around 10:30 a.m. And I'll now hand over to Richard Dennis to make an opening statement. Over to yourself, Richard. Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to come and talk to the committee this morning. I want to start by giving a huge round of thanks to your technical committee, who spent the last half an hour sorting out my technical issues and getting connected, and that their support and their calmness was much appreciated. I'm unlikely to have all the details, figures and facts at my fingertips that the committee might want. I will promise to come back in writing with data as quickly as I can after today's session where that's the case. People in unsustainable debts clearly need help. And my agency does really important work in terms of getting people a fresh start. I think it's really been pleasing listening to the evidence you've had from other contributors that in spite of all the difficulties of running a public service through COVID, I don't think any of your witnesses have suggested that the way my agency have been delivering the statutory debt solutions through the pandemic has been resulting in causing unnecessary concern or hardship to the people we all want to help. But I don't want to overplay our importance. If you look at the first quarter of this year, around 280 people a week entered a statutory debt solution. So that adds up over time, you know, 280 people a week, 1,000 a month, 12,000 a year, and we have about 50,000 people going through a statutory debt product at any one time. And that's a significant share of families in unsustainable debt in Scotland. But it's a far smaller percentage of the people the committee are thinking about how best to help. And so we are part of the answer, but I think we are only a small part of the answer. I also wanted to say up front that at the moment, we haven't seen numbers of new personal insolvencies rising sharply. They are still well below pre-pandemic levels, even if not quite as low as they were right at the start of lockdown. And while you might expect that it's too early to see the impacts of the cost of living crisis coming through in our numbers, it might be a bit more surprising that the economic impacts of the pandemic aren't coming through in terms of people entering statutory debt solutions. I was hoping, looking through the evidence, that I might have had something interesting to say about energy debt, which I suspect is very much on the committee's mind. And maybe, in fact, it is quite interesting to hear that if you look at bankruptcies awarded so far this year, gas and electricity bills are not a significant share of the debts that are being covered, and nor are they an increasing share. In fact, it's about less than 1% of the value of debt that's been declared. Again, maybe this isn't that expected. It is just too early because the big cost increases are just beginning to hit people now. What I can say and what you might want to pursue a bit later on is that looking across last year, the average monthly payment in a DAS debt payment programme was around £160 a month. And in the average trustees, it was around £150 a month. Clearly, if you're looking at a £100 a month increase in energy costs alone, that's going to have a lot of significant implications for the viability of those payment plans. But maybe news coming from elsewhere might change those figures quite substantially later in the day. And that's probably enough of an introduction for me. I'll do my best to answer the committee's questions.
Many thanks for those opening remarks, Richard. I'm going to hand over to members now for questions. And to kick us off this morning, we've got Paul McLennan. Paul?
Yeah, morning. Morning, convener. Morning, Richard. Richard, really just on about the review of the statutory debt solutions. And obviously the review that's going on at the moment, obviously I think the stage two recommendations have just been published. I just wonder if you're aware of any timescales in terms of that about introducing some of these recommendations?
Well, quite a few of them would require primary legislation. As you all know, the government announces primary legislation for the coming year in September. Were it to want to take forward some of these recommendations in that time frame, I think we could indeed be ready to pursue a bill in the next year or two, should that be attractive to government to do so.
Okay. And just to lead on from them, obviously the next stage, obviously it's stage three. I'm wondering, what, have you got a time frame for the stage three?
The Minister's working group is actually meeting again this afternoon, where that will be one of the topics for discussion. Stakeholders have been quite clear they want this to take the necessary time to get it right. So they're not looking about something quick. They are looking at a process that might well run for a year or two to do a fundamental strategic look. And we'll be talking to them again this afternoon about exactly how best to take that forward.
Yeah. Just on, I mean, obviously in the stage three, I mean, it does mention about some of the work it's likely to look in that. And I suppose one of the key things it's kind of talking about is an assessment of existing debt solutions to see if they're fit for purpose. And I suppose you just mentioned, obviously, then about fuel poverty and so on. Is that going to come into the equation? Because some of the evidence we've been taking... You're moving away from just traditional debt solutions, where it's maybe been issues around about credit, where people are actually getting with their expenditure exceeds their income. So I wonder, is that going to play a part of it, or is that going to be a wider context, if you like, within the Stage 3 review?
It'll certainly set the background and some of the context. I mean, I don't know if you've had a chance to go through the Stage 2 reviews, but actually you'll see people are largely saying that we need to make adjustments, we need to make tweaks, but generally the whole stakeholder community thinks the solutions we've got in Scotland are working quite well at present. And I think some of the witnesses the committee found have even said we've got a world-class system. And it's been nice to look down south to see them copying some of our initiatives up here, and they're hoping to introduce their equivalent of DAS, for example, I think early next year. So they are just moving to catch up to where we are. We haven't really heard calls either in the Stage 2 working groups or in the wider debate for fundamental reform. But I'll be interested in the committee's views on whether the evidence you've had also supports that conclusion that our system is broadly right at present.
OK. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. We'll now move over to a theme round about balancing the interests of creditors and people with debt problems, and I'll hand over to Deputy Convener Natalie Dawn to kick us off with that. Natalie.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. I'm wanting to focus on how do you feel statutory debt processes in Scotland should be designed to improve outcomes for people specifically on low incomes. So the Child Poverty Action Group have stated that debt processes should support the Scottish Government's national mission on child poverty. But how do we make that a reality and achieve the correct balance there? I mean, would an option, for example, be perhaps different processes in place for those on low incomes or those on benefits?
Well, to some extent, we have that already, in that the minimal asset process bankruptcy is specifically for those who have no surplus income. And a lot of folk of the categories you've been talking about will fall into that category. In fact, if you're looking at the people running deficit budgets, etc., these are precisely the sort of people that MAP bankruptcy and maybe the moratorium are there to help. Bankruptcy can't be the answer for families that just don't have enough to live on. You can't have a system designed that you go bankrupt, you get straight back into unsustainable debt, you go bankrupt, you get straight back into unsustainable debt. That doesn't work in the longer term. Bankruptcy has to be there as a sort of last resort for people who have got into a position where giving them a fresh start actually gives them a fresh start and gives them a chance to get their lives sorted out. It is a very significant step. It does have big implications. We can't, I think, see it as the answer to whether people have enough income. I think that's a question that needs to be addressed through other means, largely, I would say, suggest through the benefits system.
Thank you. Turning to private debt specifically, Do you feel that lending companies, and specifically those that are targeted at people on low incomes, should have a legal obligation to ensure that anyone that they do provide a loan to is both in a mentally fit state and in a realistic financial position where it's likely that they are in a position to repay any loan that's provided to them in the first place?
On the second half of that, I think the Financial Conduct Authority regulation in essence delivers that through treating customers fairly. The first half about mental capacity and mental state, clearly you're absolutely on the money that debt and mental health are very, very strongly linked. And one of the more interesting initiatives, which I think we should be looking to copy here, are the special protections for people in mental health crisis circumstances from down south. Whether you can put a duty on a creditor to assess a debtor's mental state before making a loan, I think that would require quite a lot of further thought.
Thank you. It's just obviously, I think mental health issues can be exacerbated by both the debt and they can be brought on in the first place by debt. And it's just a really tricky system. And it seems like more and more this is, as I say, it's exacerbating it. And it's just figuring out how to tackle that. Sorry, my last question. Do you feel that more retrospective protection should be given to individuals who were provided a loan when the company should have reasonably known or didn't make the efforts to confirm that there was no realistic chance that the individual would be in a position to repay the loan? So in terms, again, looking at some private lenders, I know some that are cropping up recently, they are providing loans and they're doing very little background checks to make sure that the person's income is enough to cover it. So, yes, do you feel there should be more retroactive protection in that way?
Well, you're getting a long way away from my area of responsibility here. What I would say is, regardless of the state of the individual and the state of their income when they took out a loan, when you apply for a bankruptcy, if that bankruptcy is awarded, your loans your debts are written off, regardless of the circumstances in which you originally took them out. And unless it can be shown that there was fraud going on. So, you know, companies don't have an incentive to lend to people who can't repay, because people who run up unsustainable debts will come through my doors and those debts will be written off and the creditor won't get any money back. It's hard to see a business model that actually is in the company's interest to lend money unsustainably. One of my other reflections, and I suspect you'll want to come on to this, taking of the evidence you've heard from the debt advice charities and others, is that actually the problems in pursuing debt are as much with the public sector as they are with the private sector. And I suspect that's partly the result of the FCA have been getting more and more muscular in terms of the way they have been cracking down on one area of poor lending after another. So payday loans have been very strongly regulated now. There's work going on catalogue loans. There's work going on hire purchase loans. And I think the general duty of treating customers fairly, as, you know, I think the FCA deserve a lot of credit, that they have actually radically changed the marketplace in the last 10 years or so, just by their very, very proactive approach to regulating where they think there are problems.
No, absolutely. We've heard throughout the inquiry that the public debt does seem to be more of a problem, and I know that we're going to come on to that later. We focused on that a lot in this inquiry, and rightly so. There's just some little things about the private side that I still have problems with. And in terms of some of these companies that are popping up, we've talked about it before, where people are buying their shoppings and spreading it over three amounts. They're incurring minimum payment charges on that. And people that are getting these loans are already in a great deal of debt as it is, so something there, the checks aren't there somewhere along the line. But no, absolutely, thank you for your comments, and I am finished for this theme. Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie, and I'll now hand over to Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, and good morning. Thank you for coming along. I suppose a couple of questions, just I'm following on from the Deputy Convener's questions. I manage, do you know what is the percentage of public debt that people are coming to with bankruptcy? How much is it being led because of either rent arrears or council tax?
I do have some numbers with me. It would take me a while to pull them together. What I would say is, if you look at creditors who are pursuing bankruptcy across the last 2 or 3 years, I mean, creditor petitions for bankruptcy are currently very, very low, but well over 60% of those in the first 3 months of this year, the creditor was a council. Traditionally, HMRC are the other big creditor taking action against debtors. They are currently just restarting their debt collection work. So their numbers aren't in the figures for the last 3, 4, 5 months. But if you look back over the last 2 or 3 years, if you put councils and HMRC together, you are probably up around the 65-70% of all creditor petitions coming from those two sources. The other big problem debt you'll get is DWP collecting overpayments of benefits and perhaps compared to other creditors, they are relatively an aggressive creditor in pursuing debt.
That's helpful. Thank you for that. It is one of the issues that creditors are trying to secure the debt against other debts and so are almost going forward with legal action to secure that? And is there any other way that we can stop people having to go to bankruptcy, but at the same time protecting the creditor from a debt that they are entitled to at some point? Or is bankruptcy the only way around that?
I'm sorry to take this cop-out answer, but it does depend on the individual circumstances. There are a large category of people in unsustainable debt whose income is not going to allow them to repay that debt, and they need to go bankrupt. They need a fresh start. There is another category of people who can, for example, use the debt arrangement scheme, who can pay their debt back, but just need time to do so. And that scheme gives them protection from their creditors, gives them freedom from interest and charges, and gives them an extended period of time to pay back the debt principal. So it does very much depend on the circumstances of the individual.
And my final question, just I suppose pushing that a bit further, is there any way, particularly for public debts or local authorities in particularly, is there any other way that local authorities could act without having to take forward putting someone into bankruptcy, particularly local authorities?
I'm sure if you have COSLA or a local authority finance director in front of you, they will all talk about their moves to enhance their fairer collections policies. What they say to us is that they will quite often consider writing off debts when they realise there is very little chance of that money being collected. And if the debtor is not in a position to pay, there is no point in the local authority pursuing them. I'm sure you will have heard from local authority advice services. Local authorities fund lots of work, either through citizens' advice or through their own service to help people. And the closer their debt collecting and their advice providers can work together, the better the outcome, both for the individual and for the council. I think if you were to talk to them about their fairer collection policy, you would start to see that coming through more and more.
Thank you, Mina.
Thanks, Jeremy. And I'll now hand back to Paul McLennan for a question to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Richard. It's really just on the report, the Stage 2 Working Group report, and one of the things around about the Protected Trust Deed. I noticed there was a bit of debate around about increasing the minimum debt level from 5,000. I just wonder if you would say a little bit more on that, because I think the exact wording was said that this remains a contentious issue with sharply opposing views. I'm just wondering if you can say a little bit more about that, if it's possible, just to try and understand what the thought process was on both sides of that.
Okay, well, I don't want to put words into the working group's mouths, but I will try, and no doubt they will write in and correct me if I get it hopelessly wrong. I think the two sides are, if you put the minimum debt level up, you close access to that product to a group of people. And there may be people whose debts are just over £5,000 for whom this is the right solution. However, if you look at running a trust deed, if your debts are around £5,000, it is quite likely that the minimum contributions you will make over the 4 or 5 year period will also come very close to £5,000. So you're close to being able to pay off that debt through a debt arrangement scheme, for example. At the same time, running a debt solution has significant costs. And if you were paying, say, £100 a month over 4 years, that's £4,800, it is likely that 80% of that, 90% of that will be consumed in the cost of the product, and very little will get back to creditors. So those who are thinking you should push that debt level up a bit will be from the position that there might be a better alternative for someone who can afford that level of contribution. And it's not hugely fair to creditors to see the sector, the administrators, taking that provision from the debtor and so little going back to the creditors. So it's that balance of closing off access to this product, which might be really valuable for certain people, against getting the balance right across the sector.
Okay. Thanks, Richard. Thanks, Camille.
Thank you. And I think I'll need to read that back to actually understand and process that answer. I think it is a complicated picture, and I think that's why it is a polarising option at the moment. Over to yourself, Emma.
Thank you, Convener. So far, I think we're really talking about how future policy will balance the needs of creditors and those in debt. But I wondered where you think the balance is now. We've heard from people who have debt and low income that even if they're successful in claiming social security, it can end up that most of their monthly payment ends up going towards paying off debt. Do you think there is balance there in considering the interests of people who are in debt now, or are we a little too interested in making sure that creditors get their debt repaid, including interest?
It's a difficult question. I think there's a number of factors here. By the time people come through our doors, their debt is unsustainable. They're not going to be able to pay it back, and they get that debt written off. And for people going through the minimal asset process, nothing goes back to creditors. The debt is just written off. Is that harsh on creditors? Probably not, because you can't get blood out of a stone. In terms of what's happening before people come to our doors, I suspect the debt advice agencies will have said pretty clearly people should be seeking advice earlier than they do. Traditionally, it can be a year, 18 months, 2 years too late. And during that period, the debtor has significant stress. The creditor has significant expense. Nobody gets any money at the end. It would be helpful if we could do more, I think, both to get better information available to people in clearer terms. And I think my agency and others plan to do quite a lot on that over the next couple of years. And if we looked again to see what we could do about reducing the stigma of bankruptcy, particularly over the pandemic, I think there may have been a change in society in that people no longer assume it's necessarily an individual's fault that they are in debt the way they did. And hopefully we will see people more prepared to come forward and ask for help when they need it as a result of that. But that bit about the balance between creditors and debtors before they come my way is a bit beyond my remit.
Okay, thank you. The Deputy Convener touched a little earlier on the issue of mental health and the responsibility to freeze interest on debts owned by people suffering illness. Taking that further and looking at interest, which is being charged on debts that we at that point reasonably know are going to be paid only through Social Security, should there also be similar consideration given there?
Um, Again, once a customer comes through my doors into a statutory debt product, the debts are either written off, or if they're in the debt arrangement scheme, interest and charges are frozen. I think the more challenging question is how you allow somebody in a mental health crisis the time to deal with their debts. I think you will have noticed that the breathing space scheme down south, which allows less time for the ordinary debtor than our moratorium, has special extended provisions for those in mental health crisis. I think that is a very interesting initiative. I don't think they've got it quite right. It's not being used very much yet, but I think we can seek to learn from that and the way it's turning out in practice. And it's certainly something I think we should be thinking about copying up here.
Thank you.
Many thanks for that. I'll hand over to Faisal Chowdhury for a question. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Given the current economic pressure, people are increasingly getting into debt just to live. The way the debt is recovered is leaving those people destitute. Do you think the balance between creditor and the debtor is right in this situation?
Could you give me an example of the type of situation you've got in mind here?
Well, the way people are, borrowing money, extra money, well, they're in debt already. Do you think that when they're taken in for bankruptcy or getting pressure, is the balance, is it the right amount, or is in this situation?
I'm not sure I can really provide an answer there. I mean, you know, one answer to that question is, what is the right level of universal credit? Should we take forward a minimum income guarantee? These are just questions that are so far beyond my responsibility. I'm not sure I can be much help. What I could say is that we are clear that the purpose of bankruptcy is to take somebody who is in unsustainable debt, who can't escape from that debt themselves, and to give them a fresh start, while bearing in mind that the needs of creditors as well. Once people have got a fresh start, the last thing we want is for them to fall straight back into unsustainable debt. Deciding whether or not they have enough income to live on is, unfortunately, nothing to do with the bankruptcy system.
We'll move on to some questions around about the mechanics of bankruptcy itself. And to kick us off with them, I'll go to my colleague, Pam Duncan-Glancy. Pam?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you, Richard. Thank you for the evidence you've provided so far and also the information you gave us in advance. I'm interested, actually, first of all, in the point about minimum income and bankruptcy and how much that leaves people with. And also, in particular, actually, I know that the fee has been lowered to access the bankruptcy options, but it's still leaving some people unprotected. So could you say a little bit about the purpose of the fee and whether or not it's your understanding that fee is becoming a barrier?
Yes, happy to address the question of fees. So currently, the vast majority of people don't pay an upfront fee. The fee for the minimal asset to process bankruptcy, which I think is the group the committee will be most interested in, is now £50 where people do pay a fee. Is that a barrier? Well, it will be for some people. Getting together £50 can be a stretch. But bankruptcy is firstly quite a serious step to take. We want people to pause and think about it. And secondly, bankruptcy has to be funded. So the fees down south are significantly above ours. So the current fee for full administration bankruptcy down south is £680 compared to our £150. And they're their DRO, which is the equivalent of our MAP, their fee is 90 as opposed to our 50. I make a huge loss running bankruptcy cases. On a full administration bankruptcy, on average, I lose over £1,500 for every case. The taxpayer very kindly picks that up for me, or the Scottish Government very kindly sends across the money we need to keep the system running. And that's a question of balance. Clearly, you could abolish fees. You might expect that to see an increase in bankruptcies as a result. I would expect to see an increase in the support I require to continue to administer them. I think that's a political judgment, and in reality, I don't have strong views one way or the other.
Thank you for that. Could you tell us approximately how much you collect in fees then? I know that you said not the majority of people don't pay, but it'd be interesting to know what that figure is. And then I have another further question, which is still related to bankruptcy, but slightly different, so I'll pause.
Just let me dig into my statistics that I've got in front of me. In the last year, only 19% of MAP cases paid an application fee. So 4 out of every 5 paid nothing.
And do you collect figures as to how much money that means that you get from the total fees paid to you?
For MAP bankruptcies, that would be a couple of hundred thousand, no more than that.
Thank you. The other thing, and forgive me if this is slightly out with your remit, but I'm interested in the issue that when some people become bankrupt, and as you say, it is a fresh start, and I can understand why it's a helpful option for people. It can often then result in people being unable to get further borrowing. Now, I'm not suggesting that people should then get into a cycle of borrowing, but even things like getting a mobile phone contract or a broadband contract can be really, really difficult. And those are things that are pretty essential, I think, and we've heard that from a lot of witnesses. What is your? Do you have any views about what we could do about that, or how we could improve that situation for people?
This is largely a question of how the credit reference agencies react to either unpaid debts or statutory debt solutions. I would say, the issue is much larger than just bankruptcy.
Richard, we seem to have lost connection with yourself. Okay, we'll
suspend that answer as well.
We will suspend briefly until we can try and get Richard back. Thank you very much. back? I think that we managed to get you back, Richard. That's fantastic. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, apologies for that. I gather the Scots network for the Scottish Government doesn't like your network.
How ironic is that? I will hand back to yourself to finish up, if you can, for Pam's question. That would be great.
Could you just remind me how much you actually heard, Ms Duncan?
Thank you, and welcome back. The question was about people's ability to borrow after they've been through the bankruptcy process, particularly in relation to things like mobile phones or broadband, and even, so it's not so much borrowing, but, you know, getting credit, as it were. And I think you'd said that it is an issue not only specifically related to bankruptcy, and you mentioned the Credit Reference Agency, and I think that's as much as I got.
Yeah, I mean, I think that would be the main point. It is about credit scores. The credit reference agencies will take into account mispayments, defaults, bankruptcies in different ways. At least when somebody goes bankrupt, they are starting the process of repairing that. And though I think it does take 7 years before bankruptcy fully comes off your credit reference report. You could legislate for that. There are countries in the world which run the credit reference agencies as public bodies. That will be quite a radical change.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Do you have examples from anywhere else in the world where it's 7 years average? Is it more, less? Like, where does it sit?
I'm afraid I don't know. We can try and do some research. I have a network of international colleagues I can ask. It may be some time before I can come back to you on that.
Okay, thank you. That's all my questions on this theme. Thanks, convener.
Thanks very much for that, Pam. And I'll hand over to Jeremy Balfour for a question. Thanks.
I think most of my questions have fortunately been covered, but the one area I just wanted to pursue briefly is that, you know, the evidence we have taken over the last number of weeks is that for many people we're in a crisis situation at this moment of time. And that may get worse into the autumn and early next year. And a lot of what you've been talking about is longer term. So it's, you know, primary legislation, it's more reviews, it's more recommendations. From your perspective, if there was the political will, what would be the, if you like, quicker things that could be done in the immediate to make people's lives easier? Or is there nothing, in your opinion, around bankruptcy that can be done in the short term to make things easier?
I think just going back on to some of the things I said earlier, it tends to be quite a while between people falling into even a financial crisis and seeking advice and then ending up in a statutory debt product. We think that gap has got smaller, but in 2008, when the financial crash hit, it wasn't until 2010 that we started to see those numbers coming through in terms of bankruptcies. There are other factors involved in that, but partly that is because people take a while to get to grips with the fact that they need to seek help. And I think anything we can do to convince people actually to go knocking down the doors of the advice agencies, they may or may not welcome me saying this, sooner, greatly improves their chance of getting a really workable and useful solution in place. I think the system is quite good. If you can see a money advisor today, you can have a moratorium in place tomorrow. The system can already react that quickly, but it does require on people taking the initiative to go and see debt advisors. And I think the more we can make information clear and simple, accessible, and make sure the advice is there for them, I think that might be the priority rather than necessarily trying to do anything overnight in legislative terms. But again, as I think we demonstrated through at the start of the pandemic, when we need to, we can put legislative change in very, very quickly too.
Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. And I'll hand over now to Miles Briggs for questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Dennis. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to debt enforcement. Last week we'd heard specifically around protections around bank balance accounts, and there was scope to increase this, the minimum protection balance in bank accounts of £1,000, providing that protection. So I just wondered what your view was on that and your experience and how that should work.
This comes down, I think, in reality to council tax collection. There is scope to do something on bank arrestments if it was judged necessary and valuable. What you're doing is taking away a tool from councils to ensure council tax collection. And the question is whether this is hitting those who can't pay or those who won't pay. We do not want it hitting those who can't pay. You know, your benefits happen to arrive on the wrong day and a bank arrestment arrives the following day, your benefits can be frozen in your bank account and you can't access them. Now, one solution to that would be making it much easier to undo an unduly harsh bank arrestment. Another way of addressing that would be by raising the level. We don't actually have the evidence we need here. We don't know how many bank arrestments are successful. We know that there are over 200,000 a year, but anecdotally, less than 10% of those actually hit a bank account because the creditor has to guess where you've got your bank account when he serves his bank arrestment. We also hear from creditors that as soon as the debtor picks up a phone and engages, they won't take enforcement action of that sort. But the evidence isn't there. And it may well be that we are in a situation where it is judged sensible, as a temporary measure, while we find the right evidence to raise that level. And that could be done relatively quickly. It would need primary legislation. But there are opportunities to do that if the committee and the government think that's a sensible thing to do.
Thank you for that. And I wanted to come on to council tax debt specifically, because we've heard how enforcement can be both inflexible and, as you've said, harsh, really, in terms of a collection. So I wondered, from your experience, what sort of levels of sustainable council tax debt do people you're usually supporting come with? I don't know if you have a percentage of what that would usually look like. And what would your reform be on your views on how that could be reformed, especially for an earlier intervention to prevent that significant council tax debt building up sometimes where individuals are moving properties as well with that attached? So I just wondered what information you had on that.
Okay. Just to correct something I misspoke in my last answer. I wasn't saying councils were necessarily unduly harsh in the use of bank arrestment. There is already a process that if a bank arrestment hits your bank account and you can go to court to get that lifted if the court thinks it is unduly harsh. Obviously, that's a court process. So if you are a family living on benefits and your benefits are effectively frozen in your bank account, it takes time to go and get them unfrozen again, and you can't really wait. The question is whether that process is right. I was not suggesting that the use of bank arrestments in itself was necessarily unduly harsh. Council tax is a significant debt in bankruptcies that we see, in a way that energy bills aren't. I wonder if that's something about more about the choice people make about which bills to pay than it is necessarily about the burden of the different impositions. And I'm not in a position to judge that. That's just a surmise that people pay their mobile phone bill because they need their mobile phone to be working next month. You might not pay your council tax one particular month because you think, well, actually, the council probably won't do anything till the end of the year. Just because it appears quite so often doesn't necessarily mean it's the root cause of the problem.
Thank you. And do you have any anecdotal evidence about what sort of levels of council tax debt there usually is when someone begins a bankruptcy? Or maybe you could provide the committee that if you don't have it to hand.
I can provide that to the committee later. I have got it somewhere in my pack of numbers, but it will take me a while to find.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks for that. And I'll hand now back over to Natalie Dawn for some questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Yep, it's just following up on some issues raised by my colleague Miles Briggs. So the AIB have stated that they will consult on changes to the law of diligence. And can I ask if we're aware what the timescale of that's likely to be and what issues it's likely to cover? Following on from the last question, I'm specifically sort of thinking about earnings assessments. And I know that you've just stated that there's a lack of evidence in relation to that. So can I ask if an evidence gathering session will go hand in hand with that consultation to make sure that we find the best outcomes?
Yes, so a number of things in there. Easy to say a straight yes to the last one of those questions. The diligence working group report has been submitted to ministers and should be published very shortly. We will be hoping to take that forward in the same time, same sort of time frame as the Stage 2 Bankruptcy Working Group reports. The type of issues it has covered, the papers the group has asked for and considered are already on the website, so I'm not saying anything that isn't already in the public domain here. There look quite a lot of the need to make the system more modern and more efficient. So there are some bizarre requirements in diligence legislation, like if you want to take diligence against a ship, you have to nail your court paper to the mainmast, which can be quite difficult in modern terms. So there is quite a lot of work in making the process better and more efficient. They've done quite a lot of thinking about information disclosure orders, where there is some legislation already on the statute book, but we need to see the detailed regulations necessary to bring that in. And I think that you can expect that to be one of the main thrusts of the work going forward. They've also decided there are a number of other issues, for example, like the family home, where again, there's legislation on the statute book that hasn't been brought into force, but they've decided it is sensible to treat that alongside treatment of family home in bankruptcy and suggested that's an issue that should be carried forward jointly in the Stage 3 of the bankruptcy review.
Thank you. Just following on from that, and again, my colleague Miles rightly raised the issue of raising the minimum protected balance. So we've also heard calls for earnings assessments to be more flexible and better coordinated. And also one of the points that's been highlighted is that there's no effort to assess an individual's circumstances prior to earnings assessment, for example, if they have children. So will further reforms to the process of earnings assessment feature as a core part of this consultation?
In terms of the administration of conjoined arrestments, yeah, I think there is significant scope for improving that. That's one of the areas we'll be looking at. The others are more complicated and I think need quite a bit of thought and some consultation. It is hard to expect a creditor to know the detailed individual circumstances of a debtor when they're going to court for an earnings arrestment. They are going to court for an earnings arrestment because the debtor is not cooperating in terms of paying the debt. So they're after a court order for it to be directly directed from their salary. It's quite hard to put the burden on the creditor or even the court to assess the debtor's circumstances and adjust the level of the earnings arrestment on that basis.
Okay,
arrestment's in play, sorry.
No, apologies. I thought you'd finished. Sorry, carry on.
Yeah, your other question was about whether it should be made more flexible. Once an earnings arrestment is in place, it is for the employer to actually administer it. So they deduct the relevant amount from the debtor's salary and send it on to the creditor. If you are going to change that too often, it imposes significant burden on employers, and we just need to balance that. So the suggestion that the creditor and the debtor might come to an agreement to adjust the earnings arrestment up or down on a regular basis puts a significant burden on the employer. And that's something I think we'd need to think through about how that impacts with payroll and other systems.
Okay, thank you. Obviously, we know that this is heavily related to council tax debt earnings investment. So, and I understand the kind of difficulties with having creditors know everything about the circumstances of the individual. Would it make sense for more onus if the councils, if local authorities are going to continue with this system of outsourcing debt collection agencies, would it be, sorry, I've lost my trail of thought. Would it be that there should be more onus on local authorities who do know more details about an individual to provide that to the debt collection agencies so that that could then be worked out? You were talking earlier about more. It works better when there is cooperation between the councils and the debt collection agencies. So in that respect, yeah, would it be better for more onus to be on the local authority?
In terms of determining their collections policy and which debts to chase, yes, I think the burden has to be very much on the local authority. And I think it's right that those councils who have gone a long way down the fairer collections approach are sort of held up as a beacon that the others should be following. Councils do tend to know their clients fairly well. On both sides, on both their revenue and debt chasing side and on the advice side. And the closer they can pull together their own in-house people providing advice to these customers and the people chasing them for their debts, I think the better. And I think there's quite a lot that can be done well away from statute and control, simply because it's in the council's best interests to make the right judgments here. You know, if they're chasing the wrong debts, it'll cost them money and they won't get anything back.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions on this, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll take our last question to wind up this session from Pam Duncan-Glancy. Pam?
Thank you, convener. And it's really just to follow up the point about breathing space. Earlier on, you referenced the Breathing Space Initiative down south, and you said that there are things that we should look to in it, but you also said there were still things that you had questions about. Could you tell us a bit more about any of the questions you have around it and whether or not you think something similar could work here?
In terms of the main breathing space, I am personally very convinced our moratorium is better than their breathing space. Now, I can see there's an argument around freezing of interest and charges, which would be nice to do, but whether freezing an interest and charges for 6 weeks makes such a significant difference that the administrative cost and burden of the scheme imposes to do that, I rather doubt. I think a lot of my concerns, if you look at take-up, so if you compare the take-up of breathing space down south to the numbers in the impact assessments when the policy was being put through Westminster, they've had less than 10% of the numbers they expected. And that suggests they haven't got something quite right in the way it's administered. Where I think we do have something to learn is the special provision they have put in place for people in mental health crisis. I can see there's a need for action in that. Again, it's not being used very much down south, which suggests they haven't got it quite right. But I think we can learn a lot of lessons from them and come up with a good proposal for the committee and for the Scottish Government to think about whether we can bring it in a way that actually delivers greater benefits up here.
Thank you. That was really clear.
Thanks very much for that. And thank you for your time this morning, Richard. And it would be very helpful for the committee if you can get back to us with the information that you so kindly said you would provide us with by the 8th of June, if possible. And that would allow us to have that information as soon as we need it. And this does conclude our penultimate formal oral evidence session on this inquiry before hearing from the Scottish Government, and the committee will also be meeting with its experts by experience panel informally on the 6th of June to take stock of the evidence heard in this inquiry and hear their suggestions for improvements as well. So I'm going to suspend the meeting briefly for a changeover of witnesses and a comfort break. So if we can come back in about 5 minutes, that would be fantastic. Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome back. We now have a short evidence session with the Scottish Commission on Social Security regarding the report on the draft disability assessment for working age people, transitional provisions and miscellaneous amendments Scotland Regulations 2022, and isn't that a mouthful, which were laid in Parliament on the 6th of May. These regulations deal with the transfer from disability living allowance to adult disability payment for adults of working age and those who have reached pension age since April 2013. And the committee is going to invite the Minister to give evidence on these regulations at a future meeting. And this morning I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting Dr. Sally Witcher, who's the Chair of SCOS, and Dr. Mark Simpson, who's a member of the Commission. Welcome to you both. And I'll now hand over to Dr. Witcher to make an opening statement. Over to yourself, Sally.
Thank you very much. We really welcome the opportunity to talk to you about the regulations this morning and our report. These clearly are exceptionally complex regulations, as you no doubt noticed. I am in fact going to hand over to my colleague Mark to talk further about, by way of an opening statement, because he was the lead drafter on this report. I would be probably best placed to take questions around the wider issues, whereas Mark will fill questions that are more detailed or matters of technicality. So I hope that's acceptable to the committee, and I'll hand over to Mark, if that's all right with you.
That's perfect. Thank you. Over to you, Mark.
Okay, thank you, convener. Sally, I'm very pleased to be here for what's my first meeting with this committee in its current form. You will know that the social security system at both UK and devolved level includes various payments that are designed to support people with the extra costs that they incur as a result of disability. I think members will all be aware that Disability Living Allowance played this role for working age people prior to 2013. At that point, a process began whereby it was replaced with personal independence payment at UK level, and in turn PIP is now being replaced by adult disability payment in Scotland. The Scottish Government's priorities, and indeed its mantra for the introduction of ADP, as with the other new disability benefits, has always been that there has to be a safe and secure transition of cases from the Department for Work and Pensions over to Social Security Scotland. And one of the things that's been really central to this safe and secure transition project has been the maintenance, basically, of parity in the eligibility criteria for ADP and PIP. And indeed, we've seen the same thing between child disability payment and DLA. The exception to that being for people with a terminal illness. And that essentially means that when people transfer from PIP to ADP, they can very easily get the same award without any complex reassessment of their entitlements. Where this all breaks down is that ADP has actually been introduced before migration from DLA to PIP has been completed. So that leaves at the minute up to 38,000 adults in Scotland who are still receiving DLA. And that's quite a significant problem from the point of view of the safe and secure transition, because DLA awards are made on a different basis to PIP awards. Therefore, they're made on a different basis to ADP awards. So to give a couple of examples of that, many people have received higher awards when they moved from DLA to PIP because it's possible to receive the enhanced daily living component of PIP without having any overnight care needs, which is in contrast to DLA. On the other hand, quite a lot of people have lost money at that point of transfer because they're able to walk more than 20 metres, which rules them out of the enhanced mobility component of PIP. Whereas they could have received the equivalent component of DLA. And even the structure of the two payments differs somewhat. There are three rates of the DLA care component, but only two rates of the PIP or ADP daily living component. I know I'm labouring this point a wee bit, but
The really crucial thing about this set of regulations is that they're only necessary because there is no simple lift and drop of cases from DLA to ADP in the same way that there is from PIP to ADP. But the Scottish Government still wants the migration process to be as seamless as possible. And that's essentially why these regulations are drafted to envisage interim award at the point of transfer, made at the same rate as the individual's previous DLA award. And only once this has been done and the case has been transferred from DWP to Social Security Scotland, will a redetermination be made within 1 year to get the individual onto the rate of ADP that actually matches up with their impairment and its effect on their mobility and their daily living, as opposed to the rate that matches their previous DLA award. So we said in our report that, that as a Commission we think this approach is broadly sensible. We did do some probing around how confident the Scottish Government was that it has competence within the Social Security Act to award ADP on the basis of a previous award from the DWP, rather than on Social Security Scotland's own evaluation of the individual's impairment in their life. And we were satisfied with the response we received from that. We suggested that the initial award to people who are transferring from the lowest rate care component of DLA should be referred to as a transitional rate award rather than a lowest rate award, just to emphasise the temporary nature of that award. Many of the people who receive that ultimately won't receive the daily living component at all once they've been redetermined, and we're pleased that the Scottish Government accepted that recommendation. And we're also pleased that people with terminal illnesses are exempt from this two-stage process, but rather they will receive their full award from the point of transfer. A number of issues do remain. First among those is that although it's not actually stipulated in the regulations that this is the case, for the time being, the intention is that this process will only be used to transfer people to ADP if they've reported a change of circumstances to the DWP or if they request to move. When we received the Scottish Government's response to a report a couple of weeks ago, there was still no decision on what the process would be for people who fall outside those groups and who are under 74 years old. It could be the same, it could be something different. We do know that for people who are over 74, that is people who were 65 or older in 2013, are going to remain on DLA even after their case transfers to Social Security Scotland, so these regulations won't be relevant to them. That aside, we're expecting that the issues that arise from this will probably be more process-related than to do with the wording of the regulations themselves. There's no getting away from the fact that this is going to be complex. People are going to be confused about what's going on. There's a challenge of making sure of trying to make people aware that they might be better off on adult disability payment, bearing in mind that those people, you know, haven't realised at any point in the last 9 years that they might be better off on PIP than they are on DLA, so they haven't asked for a transfer. Will they know that it might be in their interest to ask for a transfer now? There's also a challenge of ensuring that people understand that their initial award is temporary, especially those that I've already mentioned who move from the lowest rate care component through to the transitional rate daily living component of ADP. And that forms part of a wider issue about how Social Security Scotland is going to handle the fact that, you know, really for the first time in its existence, it's facing the prospect of having to reduce or terminate, you know, significant numbers of existing awards. Bearing in mind that the loss of a disability benefit has wider consequences, you know, for passport entitlements, in some cases for exemption from the benefit cap, this could have a significant impact on people's lives, and it's going to have to be handled carefully. So there are communication challenges ahead. There are relational challenges ahead in terms of users. We know that there's a review of ADP coming, and that there could, I suppose, be potential to kick some of these issues down the line by deferring redetermination. But that's not what the regulations envisage, and nor would that approach necessarily be risk-free either. You know, it might raise expectations that the review will result in certain outcomes, which, you know, are far from guaranteed. It could also be seen as unfair to people who've already moved from DLA to PIP and then on to ADP and who have lost money in that process, you know, if others were protected from that. So I suppose by way of conclusion, this is a relatively small but not insignificant group of people. Moving them onto ADP was always going to be a much bigger challenge than is the case for people who are already on PIP, no matter how it was approached. We hope that our report has helped to illuminate some of the issues. I'm sure at the very least it has illuminated some of the complexity. And as Sally says, we're happy to take any questions.
Many thanks for that, Mark. And as we only have a short amount of time left today for this session, as you have to leave for another meeting, I know that, I'm going to ask members to ask their questions when I come to them all together in once, if we can do that. And we're going to start with Paul McLennan, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and thank you, Mark. Thank you, Sally. Mark, you kind of touched on the issue I was going to raise around about communications. I just wonder if you can say a little bit around about the tailored communications that's needed for this group of people. I think, you know, the most common theme, disabling conditions, are learning difficulties, mental health issues and arthritis. So I'm just wondering around about, you know, what tailored communications you're thinking around about then. And I suppose, again, it's any advice or any thoughts or concerns you have around about clients who might be able to access advice on whether they should be better off volunteering to move to ADP?
Okay, I think the first part of that is more Sally's area of expertise than mine. So do you want to speak to that, Sally, and then I can take the advice issue?
Yes, I'll do my best. Clearly from everything that Mark has already outlined, there are massive complexities here and some really big differences, and there'll be certain groups that will have, that particularly going to need to understand the situation. And I think in particular what needs to be considered are the areas of difference. So it is people who currently get the lowest rate care component who need to understand the situation. There's a lot of communication to be done around the mobility component and issues around the enhanced rate. I think one concern that people are going to have is around the implications for motability and for cars, because losing those, we know, has a major impact. And it was interesting to see in the response that the government gave to our recommendations that they are looking at what they might do around that, which would be good if they can, but I think they're going to need to act fairly quickly on that. There's also sort of the implications around the fact that PIP and ADP don't specify what time of day support is required. So there needs a bit of a drilling down to identify the people who that might affect, because for DLA, it does specify nighttime care. There'll be groups of people with mental health or cognitive impairments who may now become or are more likely to qualify for the enhanced rate of ADP. And then there's also issues around terminal illness. Now, obviously people will be, where they've indicated where it's clear, they will be fast-tracked, and that's very welcome. But there are some differences in eligibility around that. ADP is more generous, and so there may be a bit of a question about how you target people who may become eligible through ADP that won't. So it's the group of people, I think there's a challenge here about particularly the scope for people to voluntarily request transfer and how they understand the implications for them. There may be, I think there's a challenge here about targeting, identifying, drilling down to the specific groups. Some are more obvious than others. Identifying third sector organisations and getting them up to speed and primed so that they're able to advise people appropriately. There are some major issues and real complexities for people transferring who are over pension age. So that is, again, an area where some very very careful communications are going to be required. I think also it may be worth just considering, because obviously carers benefits are passports for depending on eligibility for these kinds of benefits. They may indeed, they may well not be affected, but they're certainly going to have questions about that. So I think that possibly needs to be considered too. In terms of support, there are some, people are definitely going to need support. There is some an independent advocacy service available in Scotland. So there's a question here about how that plays into this, whether people can have access to that and at what point. I think there may also be some questions about what DWP is communicating around all this, because those communications, those messages from DWP clearly need to match with what Social Security Scotland and others and Scottish Government are communicating. So I think we've raised points before, and we do again here, about what Social Security Scotland can be doing in relation to people who lose entitlement. And so there's some communications, some thought to be given around that too. And again, some challenges around how you communicate what Social Security Scotland can advise on and what it can't. So I think, in conclusion, there's a great deal to think about around the communications. There are challenges around people who, frankly, will anyway be transferred through later managed migration, who may not realise that that's happening, and they need to be made aware of that so they don't inadvertently apply and then end up worse off. So basically, there are bunches of people who are going to be worse off, and there are bunches who are going to be better off, or are likely to be better off, and it's how you ensure that those people know in a timely fashion and receive support around this very complex situation.
Thanks, Sally. And I think, convener, for me, there's obviously quite a lot of work being undertaken in this, and I think it's maybe something we can discuss later on, but I think there's something we need to keep an eye on this and maybe get some further written information at the appropriate stage, because obviously there's a lot of complex work that's been mentioned by Sally there, so maybe discuss it later on, but I think there's need for the committee to pick this up at a later stage.
Yep.
Very complex. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll pass over to Natalie Dawn, who has questions to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thanks, convener, and good morning both. Thanks very much for your attendance this morning. As we've alluded to, many people have seen their awards increase as a result of the transfer to ADP, but we are obviously concerned with those who have or will lose out. Can you expand on the different options presented for the transitional protection and what the challenges might be in providing for such schemes? I'll go to, Dr Simpson first. Thank you.
Yes, sure. Thank you for the question. I think the second part of that is probably the bit to answer, in as much as, when you throw any form of transitional action into the mix, it immediately adds complexity and it adds cost, both in terms of the extra money that's being paid out in the award and the extra time that has to be spent dealing with it at the Social Security Scotland side. In terms of I've already sort of touched on the question of the forthcoming review in the opening statement, but just as supposed to reiterate a little bit, we know the review is coming, but we don't know how long that's going to take. We don't know what it's going to recommend, and we don't know whether the Scottish Government will accept the recommendations. And there'd be, hopes are going to be high in some quarters that things like, for example, the 20-metre rule for the mobility component might be relaxed coming out of that. But it's far from guaranteed. So it could be that by allowing any form of transitional protection, all you really end up doing is deferring those reductions and deferring those difficult conversations. I mean, it's possible to argue that that's not a bad thing from the point of view of the individuals who are affected, but it might equally be possible to argue that it drags things out and it increases possibly the shock when the loss ultimately if it's delayed further. That aside, looking at the things that we actually as possibilities in our report, you know, if you keep someone on short-term assistance, you know, it raises similar issues to that. But it's also worth noting that if the individual is no longer receiving any disability benefit, but they're only receiving assistance, you know, that may well mean that they lose passported awards as well. So it becomes less clear cut sort of action. As I said before, the regulations as they've been allowed don't really allow for any of those, or either of those, sort of wait and see what the review says options. There are time limits set for the initial review. There's also time set for any redetermination if that is challenged. That sort of brings us on to the other things that we talked about. So the Northern Ireland model is probably harder to replicate in Scotland. So in Northern Ireland, people who ended up with a lower TIP award compared to their previous DLA award received what was referred to as a supplementary payment, making up 75% of the difference for a year. That could certainly be replicated in Scotland. The next step that Northern Ireland did was to also compensate for the loss of disability premia and other benefits. Now, since those other low-income benefits aren't devolved, that would, I suspect, be harder for the Scottish Government to do. But nonetheless, you could, in principle, you know, partly emulate that model. And then the final option we talked about, which is more along the lines of additional protection for universal credit, would basically mean that you hold the award at the level it's at the point of transfer, but then you don't upgrade it, so it gradually fall behind whatever the upgraded award at that level is, and eventually, you know, say you're moving from the enhanced rates to the standard rate of either component, eventually the standard rate will catch up as it's upgraded with the level that you're getting. So it's more of, you know, it allows for more of a gradual adjustment to the reduction of income compared to just this kind of cliff edge drop in entitlement that would appear otherwise. So, I mean, we've not gone into a great detail on the feasibility of those in our work. We've just noted that these are models that are available, but you know, as I said, it's not in line with what's currently being proposed, and you know, it would be naive to think that there wouldn't be challenges associated with them.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that. I have no further questions, Convener.
Thank you. I'll hand over to Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you both for the evidence you've given so far. And just to remind that I am in receipt of a PIP and will be transferred at some point. The quick question I have is in regard to the backdating of awards. I noticed you comment on that. And I just wondered, could you just give us a wee bit more information in regard to that reduced ability and what financial effect will that have on some claimants?
Yeah, so this is, when it comes to thinking about backdated awards, these are slightly unusual circumstances because the individuals affected, they're moving from one agency to another. So the body with responsibility for their award is changing. It's also unusual in that for the last 2 years, DWP has effectively suspended migration of DLA claimants in Scotland onto PIP, and it did that at the request of the Scottish Government. And it's possible that some people might have missed out on higher awards as a result of that. For that reason, there's a potential case in favour of backdating awards as far as you can. Case against is obviously that Social Security Scotland are only taking on responsibility at a certain point in time. It might be uncomfortable for them to award a higher payment for the period in which DWP was responsible. It's also the case that the individuals I'm talking about even though the general migration has been suspended, they could still have requested the transfer to PIP if they thought they were going to be better off. Although, you know, as Sally was alluding to a few minutes ago, that's not necessarily easy for people to catch on to. I mean, it's an issue that we felt was worth exploring, but we don't necessarily take a view on what the right decision. You know, the worst case scenario is that you know, somebody has missed out on a higher PIP award for the last 2 years, but you know, equally the same individual could have missed out on that higher award for even longer if they, you know, if this migration to ADP hadn't been coming up and they remained on DLA for longer. You know, there is an optimistic way of looking at this, which is the move to ADP in some cases might be what actually triggers people getting that higher award.
Well, I'm done, Camina.
I think so. Can we bring Sally?
Oh,
yeah. Sally wants to come in. Thanks.
Actually, I wanted to come in on the previous question. I think Mark has covered that as well as I could, and I have nothing further to add on that one.
Okay, if you want to come in on the previous question now quickly, that's okay if you want to do that.
Okay, well, I just wanted to flag that clearly decisions about options are political decisions. They're not ones that SCOS would necessarily be appropriate to comment on, but also we don't have the information. And clearly what you have to, you know, there are things that are clearly ideal that would be potentially desirable in this scenario, but whether they're realistic or not is the challenge. So it's about, for example, we don't know yet enough about the timing of the review of ADP to get a sense of quite what is practical, what is realistic around basically putting reviews on hold until that point. We don't know enough about the financial implications of the different options, and we don't know enough about the delivery consequences. So to kind of really explore that further requires a different type of investigation, which probably the committee is better placed than we are to undertake. All that we can do in this situation is to point out the possibilities that would require or might require or be worthy of further investigation.
Thanks very much for that, Sally. I'll move on to the final two questions that we have. The first is from Pam Duncan Glancy and then Miles Briggs. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Sally, and good morning, Mark. I just have to check the clock to check it still was morning, but it is indeed. Thanks very much for setting out what is a complex situation, and I know that I myself have been trying to get to grips with it, with the information you provide in advance. So forgive me if some of this is out with your remit or misunderstood. The first question I have is a really simple one. For the 38,000 people who are on DLA in Scotland and yet to transfer to PIP, is it your understanding that leaving them to transfer to PIP as opposed to ADP would have taken longer than the process that's set out in these regulations do?
Not something that I think we've given an enormous amount of thought to. I mean, what it would mean would be that the timetable, I suppose, would be outside Social Security Scotland and Scottish Government's hands, and would be dependent on how long it took DWP. That process has obviously, has dragged on. I guess at least with this way, you can say here's a window where we transfer everyone in Scotland, and the Scottish Government can have some influence over that. I don't sense that has been a huge part of the reason, and it's more the Scottish Government's expectation that the process of getting onto ADP is going to be more claimant friendly than the process of getting onto PIP, and I think that seems to me to be the motivating factor here, rather than to do with timing.
Okay. Thank you. In developing the or in looking at this process, we obviously, and you've set this out in your evidence, there's a bit of policy divergence in that you've got the 50 metre and the 20 metre rule interaction with ADP. In any of the solutions to address the transfer of individuals on DLA to ADP, and in any of the solutions that you've outlined to address that particular problem, could those have been applied to the broader case transfer? And is there any reason why that means that they couldn't have? Because it seems like we're creating, there is by definition on the basis of what you've set out, there's going to be two different systems and inequity in it. Means some people will remain on a system that looks at 50 metres as opposed to 20. So if you're creating that anyway to deal with this caseload of people, could we not have done the same to look at extending it to the others and addressing policies such as the 50 and 20 metre rule?
I guess if you'd done it that way around, it would have looked sort of the same, only flipped in terms of the unequal treatment dimension. What you would have had then would have been if the ADP criteria had more closely matched the DLA criteria, but most people have already moved from DLA to PIP, then you've got a much larger number of people who are potentially going to have to go through that two-stage process because they would need to be, migrated and then redetermined against the new criteria. You know, the process would have been the same, but larger numbers of people would have been affected. So there would have been, resource implications for that. I guess there's, we're getting into the realms of political decisions again about how much resource is going to be put into the transfer.
Thank you. Two other brief questions. Is there any reason why the Scottish Government, or could the Scottish Government have created a lower rate ADP to transfer people onto to basically mirror the DLA caseload?
Effectively that is what they are doing, but I presume you mean keeping, retaining it as a permanent feature?
Yes.
I think that it's probably more a question for the review than for us. I presume it would have been feasible technically, but as I sort of said in the opening remarks, the emphasis has been on maintaining parity as a vehicle or as a means of achieving the safe and secure transfer. It does raise the sort of this factor of unequal treatment again, because you've got this relatively small group of people on who are still on DLA who would benefit from that, whereas the people who had already moved to PIP would not, which may or may not be a decisive argument against doing it, but that's clearly been the thinking. I think Sally wants to come in on this.
Sally does want to come in. Thank you.
Yes, just briefly, I think this is where questions around the timing of the review become important as well, and kind of what comes out of that could mean a different designed ADP. That's where the scope potentially would lie for making these sort of bigger changes. They are clearly questions around affordability and other matters that would in order to make this deliverable would need to be considered. I think one of the risks, though, that depending on the timing of that, is what you wouldn't want to see is people effectively knocked off their entitlement to the enhanced rate at this point, and then following a review, having it reinstated. Is it that all starts to get a bit messy? But that's kind of, I think, where you would position this. I mean, technically, they can design this. Realistically, whether they can or not is potentially another matter, because of all the constraints we know about, not only the ones we've mentioned around finance and delivery, but DWP attitudes towards passporting start potentially to creep in some cases. So there's and ultimately lurking in the background, you've got whatever comes out of the DWP Green Paper review about the structuring of benefits and the timing of that, because that could throw a lot of questions about the whole enterprise in some ways. I mean, it would require a fundamental rethink were they, for example, to go down the road of merging universal credit type benefits with extra cost benefits, as is one of the options that was flagged in that green paper.
Thank you. I have one further question, but I'll save it and write to perhaps write to the Commission.
Okay,
just for time.
I do think that Mark wanted to come back in on this point as well, Mark, before I bring in Miles Briggs.
No, I'm okay. I just wanted to flag that the party issue, it's not just about the transfer, it's about the possible impact on passporting as well as an issue there, but sadly has that covered.
Okay, great. And well, hand over to yourself, Miles. Thanks.
Thank you, Vinnie. It was just a brief question with regards to part four to see if there was any issues which you wanted to raise. And looking at the theme around creating a more flexible and person-centred approach, whether or not you think that's going to be achieved or if there's other things the committee need to hear and pursue on that as well.
Okay, well, I'll do the easy bit around part four, which is that we're going to be talking about this a bit more at our next board meeting, so we don't have an awful lot to say on it right now. The bits that we had said of previously were really dealing with some small drafting errors and wee bits of unnecessary duplication. There's a bit more to them now than there was at that stage, but I think we'll leave that till another day. Sally, you might be better placed to respond to the other question.
Well, I'm not entirely sure that I am, because we are going to be looking at part four at our meeting next week. Clearly, if we have any further things to add to that, we will be writing to the Minister and also the committee. We did an initial response, a very quick one, because of timelines and the things that we raised were just immediate responses, but we would like to give that a bit more consideration, so we may come back to you on that. And regarding the question or the point about person-centred, I may have misunderstood what you're getting at here, and if so, apologies, but I think part of the aim here is around trying to ensure that the more, the more supportive person-centred approach that is required of Social Security Scotland in line with expectations in the Charter is what people will be getting. And that was part of the reason for going down the road that they did, so that people weren't obliged to go through PIP assessments before. So that may not be what you're getting at, but it seems to me to be a slightly different point. Apologies if I've misunderstood.
No problem. No further questions. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you so very much for that. And thank you both for coming along this morning and giving evidence to us. And as always, your report and evidence will help us in our scrutiny function in this regard as well. So thank you both. And I will now close the public meeting and move into private session. Thank you.